I'm David Wolper. By 1941, our allies in Europe and Asia were being devastated by Hitler and Tojo's forces, yet we were reluctant to interfere militarily. The isolationist attitude that had prevailed during the first years of World War I seemed to dictate our foreign policy once again. Suddenly, the surprise attack by the Japanese on Pearl Harbor changed everything. We were finally jolted from our sideline seat to join the fight against both Germany and Japan in World War II. Our film dramatically details how the Japanese High Command brilliantly outwitted its American counterpart, at the same time grossly miscalculating the will of the American people themselves. Join me now for December 7th, the Day of Infamy.
The time to strike has come. The spirit of the Emperor flies with you. Yours is a sacred duty, your mission divine. Do not fail. The hour for which these Japanese pilots have long been secretly training has come at last. Ahead, Pearl Harbor and the United States Pacific Fleet. For Japan, a decade of waiting is over. It is 6 a.m., December 7th, the day of infamy. Sunday in December, in the year of 1941, at Pearl Harbor, the world was changed forever. It was America's darkest hour, and for both the United States and Japan, the end of a perilous journey begun many years before.
The Japanese are extremely courteous. In fact, they are often considered to be the most polite people in the world. Suppression of the emotions is one of their chief characteristics.
Cherry blossoms and geisha girls. This is the travelogue image of Japan, held by most Americans in 1930. A quaint, exotic picture postcard land, populated by a quaint, exotic, toy-like people. Behind the romantic cliché, the true face of Japan in 1930. A modern industrial state, borrowing the technology of the West. In less than 80 years, a backward feudal province has become a leading power of the world. Baseball reflects the Western influence. It's the national sport and draws fans comparable in enthusiasm only to those in the United States. Beneath the veneer of progress, the ancient traditions persist. This is the Japanese paradox. In this modern land, the emperor is still sacred, a divine being, a subject for worship. The ancient reverence for the military also remains after centuries of rule by men of the sword. But in the new changing Japan, the militarists see their traditional supremacy threatened by the democratic trend of the country. To keep alive their old dreams of conquest, the army's power over the civilian government must be restored. The solution is war. In the fall of 1931, without the permission of the government, without the knowledge of the emperor or even the War Department, Japanese military forces are committed to aggression in East Asia. It is the emperor's will, the militarists say. And the people of Japan, soldiers and their families, are ready for every sacrifice. To die in battle for the emperor is man's most glorious fate. An unauthorized unauthorized, unjustified attack on Manchuria begins. Within a few months, Manchuria is overrun. China's richest provinces now become Japanese. An easy conquest, it merely whets the military appetite. In Japan, the victory is celebrated in a frenzy of nationalist fervor. The government, the emperor, must accept the accomplished fact. The old imperialist Japan is winning against the new.
I call on His Excellency, Monsieur Matsuoka, delegate of Japan.
At the League of Nations in Geneva, the Japanese answer the charges of aggression in the Far East.
It is a matter of common knowledge that Japan's policy is fundamentally inspired by a genuine desire to guarantee peace in the Far East and to contribute to the maintenance of peace throughout the world. Japan, however, finds it impossible to accept the report adopted by the Assembly.
Led by Matsuoka, an ardent militarist, the Japanese now withdraw from the League to pursue their divine mission to rule East Asia. In order to fulfill her mission, Japan secretly expands her navy, builds the largest, fastest ships of any nation in the world. A growing fleet must have more men. We are striving for superhuman skill, graduates of the Naval Academy are told. When you are training on your ships, there'll be no Saturday or Sunday, no rest or sleep. It is a great honor, for you serve the Emperor. Japanese naval training is thorough and hard. It takes place in northern waters where it cannot be observed, and where men are toughened by exposure to the elements. The men are pawns for the militarists, who in their drive to consolidate their power, look for war with the United States. In the middle 30s, the American Navy, restricted by limitation treaties, means mostly romantic adventure. It lures recruits with southern climes and pleads, join the Navy and see the world. The ports are exotic and there's a girl in every one of them. The romantic attitude toward the Navy is even reflected in the escapist Hollywood musicals of Depression America.
David L. Wolper Presents will continue in a moment. We now return to David L. Wolper Presents.
In 1937, Japan is marching to a different tune called East Asia for the Asiatics, but it means East Asia for Japan. The first step, conquest of China. China is assaulted both by land and sea. The Japanese military are determined that China shall become another Manchuria. There is to be a new order in East Asia, they say. The Japanese have a still larger goal, war with the United States. On December 12, 1937, the American gunboat, the USS Panay, is sailing up the Yangtze. Her job is to protect American life and property in the war-torn river valley. Aboard, she carries evacuees from the besieged city of Nanking. It is a bright, sunny day. The ship is clearly marked. For Japanese pilots, there can be no mistake. The ship is bombed and strafed. Counterattack is futile. The Panay is going down. The men must abandon ship. Three men have been killed, 11 seriously wounded. The attack has been deliberately planned. To solidify their position of power, the Japanese military hope to provoke a war with the United States. At 3:45, the Panay goes under. The civilian government of Japan apologizes to America through Ambassador Hiroshi Saito.
It was a great mistake. The Japanese government and people wished to express their sincerest and profoundest regrets to the American government and people on account of this deplorable incident.
A confused isolationist America, anxious to avoid war, gladly accepts Japan's apology. And while protesting the aggression in China, continues to sell the means of war to the aggressor. Almost 90% of Japan's aviation gasoline, scrap iron, and steel come from the United States. For now, it is put to use over China. In Japan, the people sing their undying devotion to their emperor. Neither they nor he can stop what has started. For now, on the ancient throne of Japan, sit firmly entrenched the gods of war. In Germany, another captive people, hypnotized by a promise of grandeur, cheer the visit of a friend, Yosuke Matsuoka. He has come to promote an alliance with Adolf Hitler, who is preparing for war in Europe. The British and French possessions in Asia will be vulnerable. A German alliance now will ensure Japan its share later. There is little difference between Nazi doctrine and Japanese policy. And to Matsuoka, Germany is the model of what Japan hopes to be. Matsuoka departs, having drawn Japan's ambitions closer to German might. A formal alliance is still to come, but the ring of tyranny is closing. And a world on the threshold of war does little but watch and wait. Spring 1940. War has come to Europe. President Franklin D. Roosevelt decides to move the expanding United States fleet nearer the strategic places America must protect: the Philippines, Wake Island, and Guam. It is to be called the Pacific Fleet. Its destination, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, 2,500 miles closer to Japan. In Japan, the movement of the American fleet causes a cabinet crisis. Germany has conquered Holland and France. Their Asian empires are ripe for plucking, except for the proximity of the Pacific Fleet. A new cabinet is formed with General Tojo as Minister of War. He presses for an Axis alliance to frighten America into remaining neutral. Premier Kanoya is against it, but both Tojo and the new foreign minister, Matsuoka, have their way. September 27th, 1940 is a festive day in Berlin. The Axis powers, once two, now are three. Germany, Italy, and Japan, each pledged to the others in case of attack. America will have to remain neutral or face a two-ocean war now that Germany is united with Japan. Now Japan prepares to launch her drive toward Southeast Asia, storehouse of tin, rubber, and oil. She is confident that Germany will come to her aid if the United States interferes. Japan has much in common with Nazi Germany: respect for military strength, belief in a super race. Even her modern mechanized army, powerful and poised for action, has been built on the German model.
David L. Wolper Presents will continue in a moment. We now return to David L. Wolper Presents.
In 1940, trucks marked tanks are being featured in U.S. Army maneuvers. Wooden machine guns, stovepipe anti-tank guns, improvised mortars with empty beer cans for ammunition. They are symbols of a pacifist America slumbering in a dream of peace. In 1940, while Asia smolders and Europe burns, America argues. There is sharp division. Intervention or isolation? That is the embattled question that tears the nation asunder. The America First Committee is among those opposed to President Roosevelt's plea for preparedness and aid to Britain and China. Its chief spokesman is Charles Lindbergh.
France has now been defeated, and despite the propaganda and confusion of recent months, it is now obvious that England is losing the war. I believe that... And I have been forced to the conclusion that we cannot win this war for England, regardless of how much assistance we send.
If Great Britain goes down, the Axis powers will control the continents of Europe and Asia and Africa and Australasia and the high seas. We must be the great arsenal of democracy. For us, this is an emergency as serious as war itself.
In October 1940, over violent opposition, Roosevelt pushes through America's first peacetime draft.
The first number drawn by the Secretary of War is serial number 158.
15 million men become government issue, and reluctantly, America takes a giant stride toward commitment. Yet protest remains part of the American scene. The United States is still a country divided. When the Draft Act is extended, it passes by a single vote. In Japan, a whole nation is being conscripted, mobilized. The entire civilian population is trained for any eventuality of war, including attack from the air. Indoors for air raid drill, outdoors for poison gas. Men, women, and children are called to rehearse with deadly seriousness their respective parts in the drama called war. The Japanese military proceeds with its plans for the conquest of Southeast Asia. With Europe tied down by war and the United States by indecision, this is the golden opportunity. The Dutch East Indies, British Malaya, the Philippines are scheduled for conquest. But French Indochina must be taken first. In July 1941, the Japanese occupy Indochina and begin to march towards Southeast Asia, the oil deposits of the Indies. To lubricate her war machine, Japan needs oil. And for oil, she is still dependent on the United States. In Washington, Japan's move into Indochina is met decisively. In treaties against aggression, material aid to China, even an embargo on scrap iron, have failed to restrain the Japanese. Now Roosevelt announces he is freezing Japan's assets in the United States, choking off Japanese trade. Japan shall have no oil with which to make war. The Japanese shocked study the situation. Soon there will be no oil for domestic use, much less for war. But a military withdrawal means losing their long-awaited opportunity for expansion. Something must be done. They give Japanese Ambassador Nomura 6 weeks to reach a peaceful settlement with the United States. If trade with Japan is restored, he tells Secretary of State Cordell Hull, the advance will end with Indochina. Says Hull, they must get out of Indochina, and China too. It is October 12th. Nomura's deadline has passed. Premier Kanoya, fearing war, asks Tojo's consent to withdraw from China. Tojo refuses. Kanoya resigns. And the man called the Razor becomes Premier of Japan. Now Admiral Yamamoto is ordered to proceed with his plan, once thought suicidal. A carrier strike on Pearl Harbor, 3,500 miles away. If negotiations in Washington fail, the assault must be ready. Preparations begin immediately. Premier Tojo is among the few in on the secret of one of history's most ambitious schemes for conquest. Besides Pearl Harbor, under attack will be the Philippines, Malaya, Hong Kong, Guam, and Wake Island, to be followed by an invasion of Southeast Asia. That is the real goal. But the U.S. Pacific Fleet blocks the way. In November 1941, the Pearl Harbor Strike Force prepares to rendezvous in Tonkan Bay. The attack is set for December 7th, a Sunday, a day of rest when the American fleet will be at anchor, says Admiral Yamamoto. You will advance into Hawaiian waters, attack the main force of the United States fleet, and deal it a mortal blow. Meanwhile, in Washington, Japanese envoy Karusu arrives on a mission of peace.
You all know how difficult my mission is, but I'll do all I can to make it a successful one for the sake of two countries, Japan and the United States.
Magic is the code name for one of the greatest military secrets in American history. Combined Army and Navy operations have broken Japan's top diplomatic code. Messages from Tokyo to the Japanese embassy in Washington are being intercepted and translated. On November 20th, the Navy translates a message to Nomura and Karusu, giving them but 5 more days to reach a settlement with the United States. On November 20th, when Nomura and Karusu visit the State Department, knowledge of their instructions precedes them. They come to demand oil and the end of aid to China. Tojo will not allow any concession, claiming America will not risk war. Negotiations reach an impasse. Unknown to the envoys, the Japanese strike force is about to be sent on its way. Tonkan Bay in the North Pacific, November 26th, 6 a.m. The strike force turns southeast and begins to make its way towards Pearl Harbor. Only a miracle in Washington can call it back. At Pearl Harbor, naval intelligence tracking ship movements loses the Japanese fleet. November 26, Washington. A decoded message from Tokyo is prepared for the State Department. Urgent to both you ambassadors. There must be an agreement by November 29th. This time we mean it. The deadline absolutely cannot be changed. After that, things are automatically going to happen. For Hull and Undersecretary Sumner Wells, the crisis deepens, but there will be no appeasement. On the same day, the Japanese envoys are presented with Hull's restatement of America's position. The embargo on oil will be lifted when Japan evacuates both China and Indochina. The United States will wait for an answer. Nomura and Karusu know Tojo will never concede. So does the United States. November 27th, Pearl Harbor is sent a war warning. Hostilities may ensue. Hawaii is ordered to take defensive measures and is alerted against sabotage. So that they may be easily guarded, planes on airfields are bunched together. But Japanese movements towards Southeast Asia, perhaps to Singapore or even to Borneo, seem to indicate the attack will not come here.
December 1st, Tokyo. The Japanese Imperial Council approves Tojo's decision to begin the war with the West. The date is confirmed, December 7th. The Pearl Harbor Strike Force, midway between Japan and Hawaii, December 2nd, 5:30 p.m. From Admiral Yamamoto comes the message, climb Mount Nitaka. It means proceed with the attack. Washington, December 6th. President Roosevelt sends a personal plea for peace to Emperor Hirohito. Meanwhile, the Navy is secretly decoding the belated reply to Hull's last proposal. Addressed to the envoys, who are warned not to break off negotiations, the reply rejects all compromise. Cordell Hull is summoned to the White House by the President for an emergency conference. Says Roosevelt, this means war. Long into the night of December 6th, the White House lights burn. The Japanese are bound to attack. But when and where?
David L. Wolper Presents will continue in a moment. We now return to David L. Wolper Presents.
December 7th, 4 a.m., 320 miles north of Pearl Harbor. Aboard the carrier Akagi, the radio is tuned in to Honolulu. Nothing seems amiss. At full speed, the carriers race southward to the plane's launching point. It's 5:30 a.m. They are 285 miles north of Oahu. They are approaching the launching point. the time has come. All of the ships carry Shinto shrines at which pilots pray for the success of their mission. On deck, the planes are ready. These last moments give proof to the correctness of Yamamoto's plan. They have traveled 3,500 miles undetected. The rest is up to the pilots. Their prime target, the backbone of the U.S. Pacific Fleet, the eight battleships moored in Pearl Harbor. Planes will take part in the attack. Says Admiral Yamamoto, the moment has arrived. The rise or fall of our empire is at stake. December 7th, the day of infamy. On the northern tip of Oahu, a radar station is turned on by an Army trainee practicing on his own time. 7:06, a large blip appears on his screen. Something must be wrong with the equipment, he feels. But finally, he reports a large number of planes coming in from the north. He is told to disregard them. They must be our own. He continues to watch. At 7:15, the planes are 92 miles away. 7:30, 47 miles. 7:39, 22. December 7th in the United States. Sunday like any other. Before it is through, the lives of most Americans will be changed forever. The British are bombing Berlin, the Luftwaffe burning Britain. The White Cliffs of Dover is the jukebox favorite. But more popular are green eyes and blue champagne. The war is thousands of miles away. At the Polo Grounds in New York, a crowd of 55,000 are watching the Dodgers defeat the Giants. The temperature is 37 degrees. The Midwest is blanketed with snow. Milk is 9 cents a quart. Bread, 9 cents a loaf. At the A&P, coffee is 2 pounds for 37 cents. A porterhouse steak, 29 cents a pound. These prices, like many old familiar things, will soon disappear. The island of Oahu sleeps peacefully. A few fishing boats may be seen, but no offshore patrols of any kind. It is an ordinary Sabbath morn. On the battleships moored in harbor, the men are just waking. On the airfields, the planes remain neatly grouped together under the brightening sky. under counterattack, the airfields are hit first. The planes parked closely together make an excellent target. At 7:57, the main target lies below. Battleship Row. Japanese torpedoes, specially designed for shallow water, will now prove their worth. After the initial shock of attack, the Navy begins to strike back. Japanese, the loss of a few planes is insignificant. The attack is proceeding even better than planned. In 15 minutes, Hawaiian air power is virtually wiped out. Now, the final assault on the Pacific Fleet.
David L. Wolper Presents will continue in a moment. We now return to David L. Wolper Presents.
The spine of the Pacific Fleet is broken, sunk, The battleships Arizona, Oklahoma, West Virginia, California. Damaged, the Maryland, Pennsylvania, Nevada, Tennessee. Lost, the lives of 2,400 American servicemen. Responsibility for the Japanese success will be inconclusively placed at many doors. Washington, the commanders at Pearl Harbor, the American people themselves. But on December 7th, one thing is certain. Although the success of their attack far exceeds their expectations, the Japanese have made a fatal blunder. For out of the smoke and ashes, out of the shame of defeat, will rise a divided people become whole, brought at once together by the events of this single day.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. Yesterday, the Japanese government also launched an attack against Malaya. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Hong Kong. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Guam. Last night, Japanese forces attacked the Philippine Islands. Last night, the Japanese attacked Wake Island. And this morning, the Japanese attacked Midway Island. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
Divided America becomes united by a common purpose. Clouds of confusion and dissension have disappeared. In their place, resolution, unanimity, and a promise shared to win the war. As always, war means the separation from loved ones and an uncertain future. The Japanese believe the United States will settle for a negotiated peace. But they fail to understand they're dealing with a changed America they themselves have shocked into action. Before the ultimate victory is won. It will not come easily, but for the men at the fighting fronts and for those they left behind, the bitter memory of Pearl Harbor and December 7th cannot and will not be erased. ¶¶ Today at Pearl Harbor, a monument spans the sunken hull of the USS Arizona, which went down on December 7th with more than 1,100 men. Every morning of the year, a color guard comes to raise the Arizona's flag, for she is still a commissioned ship of the U.S. Navy. Her monument is dedicated to those Americans who made the ultimate sacrifice for their country on December 7th, 1941. May God make his face to shine upon them and grant them peace.